Well, hi there. I'm Diana Montford, the world's first transgender television journalist. Born male, became female. I just have to make that clear. People say, what direction are you going in? Anyway, let's just say non-binary, and that solves all the problems. My guest is self-described drag queen, Ms. Curtsy, as in Curtsy to the Queen. And she is going to tell us all about her fascinating life, her fascinating associates, and some of her life philosophy, which is quite profound and applicable to all lifestyles, not just an LGBTQ lifestyle. So here she is, Curtsy.
Yes, hello, and thank you. You know,
this is water, by the way.
Yes.
To those nasty people who think it, look, see, it's just plain old water from the water cooler here at Manhattan Neighborhood Network. Anyway, you were saying, this ain't Dean Martin you're looking at. I should be so lucky. He was gorgeous and rich and all that good stuff. Yes.
You get my molecules excited. It's so wonderful to be here with you.
It's a pleasure to have you.
It's a great thing. It lifts up my spirits, and I thank you very, very
much.
And
you lift up everyone's spirits. Thank you.
Yeah, bring a little, you know, I heard an old saying as a child, like growing up, I was watching television. You know, back in the 60s, you know, you were glued to the TV.
Far out. Yeah. Groovy.
But I was fond of Julia Childs, the French chef.
Yes.
And, you know, years later in her life, she was in her 80s, and they would interviewing her, and they said, gee, how do you keep doing it? And she thought a moment, she said, well, you know, first I get up out of bed and I put on a little bit of makeup, you know, go face the day. And each day is a new day. And I think that's, you know, a good guidepost to start the day with, or, you know, outlook on life.
If you're into makeup, if you're not into makeup, just get up.
Yeah,
but and if you can't get up, put yourself just together. Lie there and be happy.
Yes. You know? Yes.
So now, the last time you were on, we were talking about your life partner, the immortal, the world famous Jack Darashaw, who is also known as Flawless Sabrina, who is also the producer and MC of the 1968 film The Queen, which is a great film and you should see it. Yeah. It is an amazing film. And it was made in the dark ages of transphobia, homophobia, life phobia. It was a transgender pageant, which took place, I believe, at Town Hall in 1967. And it was released as a film in theaters, as a feature, in 1968. And it has since accrued a cult following, naturally. And it is a great film. And we wouldn't have it without Flawless Sabrina, a.k.a. Jack Darashaw.
I would just add to that he was the most dearest, wonderful person in all the world, and I'm totally biased in that, but I still believe it with all my heart, and he was the love of my life. And I don't know if that goes on the awards channel, but in my life, it was the top award.
Good, good, good.
Yeah.
Can you come a little closer?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. For the camera. And now, he died at 75, I believe.
Yes.
Fairly recently.
Yeah, 2 years ago. So it's
Which would be 2017?
Yes, 2017.
And he 18th. Lived and loved and had a great life.
Yes, he did. Not without struggle, and like with everyone else, you know, he wasn't a superhuman, but he had a super heart and a big capacity to love and care about others, that and with enormous patience, and didn't, you know, you take the whole basket together. You know, whatever the person is, that's what they are, and look on the bright side of life, and look on the bright side of each and every individual.
You know, those bracelets are making noise.
Yeah,
and it's bad for the soundtrack. But anyway, you call yourself a drag queen. You have no problem with that phrase.
No, because I come from, you know, growing up in, well, not growing up, but life in New York as enjoying drag. And I use a very broad definition of drag. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't have to be a female impersonator or anything like that. It's just dressing for the party.
Right.
You know, add a little extra pizzazz or style to life.
Yeah. Well, Sylvia Rivera used to say that she wasn't a female impersonator per se. She just liked wearing makeup and dresses. And,
yeah.
You know, it's not as cut and dried and black and white as some people think it is, you know?
Yeah, I think, in broader society, mainstream, you know, you're sold this idea of beauty and that it comes in a package at the makeup.
Well, the cosmetic manufacturers wouldn't have it any other way, you know?
And it's a very ancient thing to decorate yourself. I mean, and some people do it without makeup, but they do it with, you know, piercings or tattoos are very popular, that sort of thing. It's still decorating yourself, a hairstyle. And it's what you announce to the world, like, this is my style, this is you know, what I have to offer, and this is how I'm bringing it to the table. And they're powerful things, I think.
Yeah. And also, as we know, the shamans of other cultures, certainly in ancient times, merged the masculine and feminine into a new entity, you know?
Yeah, I think anytime you cross boundaries and cross borders, like you step out of the norms, it just adds an extra charge to life and makes life a little bit more interesting, not only for yourself, but for the others around you. And nice way to go, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So now, if someone is at home and wants to put together a drag look, how should he or she, there are female drag queens, go about it?
I don't think it, this is even before drag, you know, we tend to mimic. We mimic others around us, or, you know, for me, it was the icons of comedy that I looked towards was Phyllis Diller, Joan Rivers. This is a Joan Rivers original coat from QVC.
Wonderful.
Yeah, they brought a silliness to their persona. And it was part of their persona that they projected in their look. A little bit of zany, and those are things.
Poor Joan Rivers, she wouldn't like hearing that. But
well,
okay.
She had a great sense of humor. She was a lot slicker than I am, that's for sure. But Lucille Ball, and these are strong women. They're very, not just presented as the quote-unquote dizzy blonde or blonde, you know, airhead, but they weren't at all. They were very smart and, mm-hmm. and powerful people that, you know, made a difference.
Which was not popular in their day.
Yeah, I'm sure they were always fighting the male establishment.
Marlo Thomas, who produced and starred in That Girl, the 60s television series, wrote that she was so resented by the men on her set. And only she, the hairdresser, and the makeup artist, and the costume designer were women. All the writers, the camera people, everyone else was male. When she would go into the ladies' room, she heard that the men on set would sneer, yeah, she's in the men's room with Lucy having a meeting. Because both were powerful women, both helmed their own TV shows. Lucy also was the first female studio head, you know, Desi Lu, and they were hated for it. You would think that the men would be grateful to the person who signed their paychecks, but they despised the fact that what they considered a 17th class citizen, i.e. a woman, had that kind of power and economic clout.
Yeah, I think that's when you see it's challenging establishment. An establishment is, you know, they don't even realize they're in a class of privilege a lot of times. That they're
who, the men?
Yes, I think it's a white male.
Yeah.
It's been eons of that, and it's changing. And it's early markers, there are early protagonists like that that started changing things, you know.
You'll notice that in spite of the change is making rich old white men crazy, And they're getting vicious now.
Yes.
Like cornered rats.
Like to think it's a sign of desperation on their part that, you know, the ship's going down, so, you know.
Push those women and children off the lifeboat and get in it yourself, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's not easy to be anything other than a rich old white man, is it? And even they have their problems, you know?
Yeah, and I think it helps if you possibly don't take yourself so seriously, and that's where one of their weak points is, that they take themselves so seriously, or they being that class of people that have always been in charge or think they know everything or they think they're running the world, and they're not good at it particularly.
It's funny, you know, I'm into UFOs and paranormal and parapsychology, and supposedly the space aliens do not want to give us technology or come to see us because they know that we're a hostile, warlike, primitive people, and that whatever advanced technology they give us, we will turn into a weapon.
Yes.
You know, I mean, so anyway, but you are basically the anti crazy old white man person. In other words, you have nothing in common with Donald Trump or the other folk.
Yes. I mean, I like to think of myself because I think of it as
because you're free.
Positive. Well, as being a counter-revolutionary or counter-cultural. I'm going against the mainstream.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not an activist because I think that takes a lot of strength and a really good articulation.
Just by
of
existing, though, you're an activist.
Yes, I show up and dress the part and try to make a
And you're being
there.
Seen all over the world on this
show. Yeah, and I have perfectly happy to open my mouth. I have no problem with that. I am a conservative in that, you know, I want to conserve the planet. I want to conserve the environment. I want to conserve civil rights.
That's a new take on being a conservative.
Yeah, conserve the Constitution. Those great things to conserve. So in that sense, but to be a, it's a plethora of like these corporate mantras that are going out, these corporate funding of the don't change, don't do anything different, you know, political agendas that are not open to any sort of new idea or any sort of imagination. It's just stay with the old stuff because then, you know, it's safe for them. But it doesn't help anywhere else. The change is going to come anyway, and they're just, I don't know what their goal is, to, you know, make a quick buck or, you know, make sure the bottom line comes out okay.
The terrible thing is that so many politicians today, we're shooting this in 2020, are doing away with the safety nets that people who have no other recourse, for example, people who work at Walmart, who when they get the job are also given an application for food stamps, apparently. The food stamps are going. How are they going to feed their kids?
Yes, it's an incredible amount of meanness. It's like, you know, it's not a new tactic. It's old as let them eat cake, the poor starving people, we'll let them eat cake. Can't they just, you know, live like I live, you know? And not only is it, I find, indecent, but it's so unproductive and not helping at all. It's just cementing their power base or, you know, addressing the minority.
That's what they think is the good thing.
Yeah, and it's always waved about with a American flag or patriotism or,
if you don't agree with us, you're not a good American,
kind
of thing. Actually, if you don't agree with us, you're not. We are the real America. You're looking at the real America. You know we are.
Yeah, stand up and be counted, you know.
Just how many gazillionaires do you know? Not many.
Yes.
We are America, you know.
I know it's very difficult times and it's a very dark times in that this an incredible amount of unkindness and meanness in the world, and those are kind of general terms, but this sort of reliance on things that don't work or are false, mm-hmm. and I don't believe that's the case. I don't believe that's the majority of people. I think people are inherently good. And what's more is, you know, the folks with imagination, that is a way to go forward. You know, you have come up with a new idea or just try something new or willingness to try something or be accepting of something that's a little bit different than your own way of life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, as you know, Donald Trump recently threw out all the transgender folk in the armed forces, which is actually illegal because equal protection under the law.
Yes, and you know, Trump is the worst example of it, but it's a thing to It's I hate to say it's so basic, but it's like, you know, schoolyard bullies
exactly.
that just pick on the weakest. You know, just for their own self-import and for no greater good. And I think in the political race, you know, it was not the strongest voice, but Pete Buttigieg. You know, he's off-center,
yeah.
Buttigieg. And he's off-center, but he's comes with a great moral decency, a compass, you know, of right and wrong.
And also,
doing, you know,
he's gay, which
yeah.
we like, you
yeah.
know?
I
like Elizabeth Warren myself.
I like them all. You know, one of the most positive things is, how about this for a big change? There's a lot of choice. There's a lot of choices. Wow, we can see choices. There's different people, different opinions, mm-hmm. and, you know, each has some of its own worthwhile things in it for their own sake and like that. But just to show that there are choices, whereas the other side offers, here's one, and you know, it's
take
not
take it or leave it.
It's
and
not
you're
a going democracy.
To take it, yeah.
It's not a candidacy.
I'm afraid that if he loses the election, he won't go.
I know there is fear.
No,
of that.
I'm
yeah,
serious,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
and we'll start some kind
I,
of
I'm
civil
laughing,
war.
But I think
he actually
yeah.
said that.
Yeah, I know. Yes,
and
I
mean, that is not democracy.
It's not America.
That is not the U.S.
Yeah. And to be a leader, you want to be show that you have that imagination to present different choices or new ideas for something to change something a little bit, and not these entrenched old ways of, you know, funding a wall to, you know, make barriers. You know, you want to bring down
barriers.
That
is insane. And separating families and putting children in cages and I mean, please, you know,
yeah.
that's an affront to human decency.
Yeah, but I, you know, to be weary of that way of working is, you know, to make such a scandal and sensation to keep people's focus off of anything that is real. That you know,
yes.
yeah,
to do something outrageously wicked to hide even greater wickedness.
Yes.
You know?
Well, it's just greed and selfishness, I think, basically.
You know, this show goes into the National LGBTQ Archives at the center. And someday, a century from now, someone will watch this. And they'll wonder, Trump, he was a president, wasn't he? He'll wonder why we were discussing him at length. It would be like watching a show now in 2020 from 1969 or 70 and seeing people say, well, Nixon this and Nixon that.
Yeah.
It's going to seem so period, you know?
Yeah. Well, these are the
high
times
posterity.
We live in, and yes. And I don't, you know, as a gay, it's a lifestyle that, or my own queerness or whatever that is. I always knew I was sort of different and a little bit of a flake.
But I always knew I was.
I don't see myself as separate from the rest of humanity. I think people are people, you know.
Yeah, well, if you cut us, do we not bleed, you know? Whereas, of course, to some people, we are very much the other and not entirely human by their lights, you know?
It's a little narrow thinking. I don't know where. It's not the whole idea of narrow thinking is so you don't get far, you don't move along, you don't change, you don't develop. And it's
well, yes, but for example, some organized religions consider thinking and growing and developing sins. If you don't accept, you know, exactly what they tell you, you're a bad person and it is, quote unquote, Satan tempting you.
Yes, a lot of that goes to, you know, keep the people down, you know, keep your minds closed and let us do all the thinking for you. You know, it's a sort of a bit of a, you know, contradiction in human psychology that we tend to be lazy sometimes. It's nice if other people provide all the answers for us, and to have to come up with our own answers for ourselves mm-hmm. is a challenge. And, yeah. you know, you can, you know, turn the channel anywhere you want and turn on whatever, you know, you want to see and be and for yourself. You know, you can...
Yes, but other people police you and try to force you into the narrow row they hoe, you know?
Yes. This, you know, it's powers that be, that, you know, the greater forces. You know, we live in a surveillance state and in capitalist society, and what are they all policing? I don't even know.
I don't either. And I mean, your own phone might be listening to you or watching you. Your own computer is photographing you. The television you're watching this on might be watching you for all we know. I mean, you know, what is this, you know?
There's not enough people to watch all
Big
the watching.
Big Brother is watching,
yes.
It's very Orwellian now. George Orwell was a mystic to foresee this, you know?
Yes.
Because it's ridiculous. It's, what exactly do they think we're going to do? That's so awful, you know?
Point out the inequity of their bad behavior.
Which is good behavior, because that's Orwell speak. Good is, bad is good.
Yes.
Slavery is freedom. Yes, war is peace. Yes.
Yeah, and you hear that a lot in this diatribe, not only from Trump, but from that whole machinery behind him, the Republican parties and the conservative funding groups that have that, like, one mantra, you know, and it's all in doublespeak. You know, they're the most immoral people saying, oh, no, well, we're the good people. You
exactly.
know, and that's bad. Look at that. They're, you know.
These people. We're the moral people. We don't like people yes. who are free or who think for themselves or who have self-determination. You have to be a good little slave to the system we've created and that benefits only us. And yeah. then you're a good person. Yeah. That's basically what they're saying.
Yeah.
Well, I was talking to someone recently and I was criticizing Trump and she said, well, but I think we should have a certain respect for the presidency. I said, well, when Trump tries it, the rest of us might consider it. No, we are a republic. The president is here for the people. The people are not here for the president. And that's something that's been forgotten recently, you know?
Yeah, it's that mindset of go along with the what is perceived as the majority. And I think it's a lot
of... Well, as Nixon said 50 years ago, the moral majority.
Yes.
I.e. not hippies, not free thinkers.
And Goebbels, back in the Nazi times, yes. he said, you know, you tell a lie enough times and people will start to believe
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
And it's out there on these channels that are monopolized by, I think it's a lot of corporate money behind it, that, you know, concentration of wealth that's behind
yes,
these conservative
yes.
factions. That, it's so, and it sort of feeds into this own system of you know the Republicans who, if they want to get elected, the only way is to get the money from the Republican Party,
yeah.
and that money is locked up by you know okay, well this is what you say and this is how you say it and this you know here's your script. Everybody stay on script.
Oh well,
stay
they do that script. Even in the Democratic Party.
Yes. Yes,
I was in Democratic politics, and at the beginning I didn't know much about it, but they just. Like the way I looked, they told me that. So they drafted me, and they would write questions for me on little slips of paper to ask at press conferences, you know, and they'd say, here, learn this fast. I'd read it, and then I'd say, excuse me, I'd like to know, and because I'm an actress, I could make it sound bizarre, I just thought of it, but it was bullshit, you know?
Yeah.
Politics is not a great business.
Yeah, it's, what do they call it? The showbiz without the laugh.
Or they also call it show business for ugly people.
Yes, well done, yeah.
So anyway, but now, for example, I love AOC, Alexandria Ocasio Cortez.
I think she's made a
and
huge
she's beautiful,
in the
by
world.
The way.
Yes.
She's certainly not ugly.
Yeah, and she's smart and she's energetic and she's tough.
Yeah.
She's from the Bronx. That's it. That's enough said
and that's
there.
Hope.
Yeah.
And by the way, if you live in the South or the Midwest, why are you watching this show? But what I mean is, if you're going to vote for Trump, just wait, because he'll take away all your safety net. And you can wave your little guns and wear your little Make America Great Again hats. But he's not making America great again. He's making it, you know, 1880. With people living in the streets and eating out of garbage cans. So you stop and think about that a while, you know?
Yeah. But there you know, you mentioned AOC, and that's just one. There has been a huge, movement, not just from the Me Too movement, but a women's movement and a rise of female.
Trump is a great uniter. Everyone hates him.
Yes. Yeah, and I don't think it's just in that. It's just that to say, you know, there's enough examples to say, yes, okay, there's the forerunners and we can do it too, and more people being involved and they want to be involved. And I think I hold a lot of salvation on with that. You know, I think a more female world is a better vision.
I couldn't agree more. Let me drink some water. My guest has been self-described drag queen Curtsy, who also describes herself as a sculptor for change.
Yes.
I'm Diana Montford. This has been the Diana Montford Show. Look, just be yourself. And, you know, there's an old Billie Holiday song, I've been down so long, down don't worry me none. When you're an outcast, there's freedom in that, you know? It's not as bad as it seems.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know? So, I mean, it's not as bad as it seems. So, anyway, as an outcast, I can say that. What am I cast out of? That's what I'd like to know. But anyway, my guest has been Curtsy. I'm Diana Montford. Even if no one else loves you, we love you. And you take really good care of yourself. And remember, love yourself.
Love yourself. You rule.
Yes, and if you don't, love you. See you next time. Bye.
Awesome. Just awesome.
Yourself.
I did it twice.
You did it twice.